Hello, everyone. I'm Brian Hansen. I'm the Vice President for Studies here at the Chicago Council, and I want to welcome you all to this event. This is a terrifically wonderful event for us at the Council because we are talking about our survey, and everybody's got a copy of our survey report on their table. And the Council on Global Affairs has been conducting a public opinion survey since 1974, and it's become really a very trusted and widely cited source of longitudinal data on American public opinion, covering a wide range of issues. And this election campaign has surprisingly, I think for many people, had a great deal of content as well as focus on global issues, with fundamental questions about what is the relationship between the United States and the world and how that might be changing. The 2016 report that we're going to talk about today focuses on partisan trends, dividing lines, and often surprising convergences in public opinion, broken down by party affiliation. And there's a particular focus on the foreign policy views of Donald Trump. I look forward to our discussion of these issues and the implications that reach well beyond November 8th in this election. I should say that for over a century, or for nearly a century now, the Chicago Council on Global Affairs has provided an independent, nonpartisan platform for a variety of voices to promote deeper global understanding and active U.S. engagement in the world. The views expressed at all of our events and platforms are those held by the individuals and do not represent the views of the Council. And turning back to this afternoon's discussion, let me just introduce our panelists briefly. We have in the middle Ivo Dalder, who's the president of the Chicago Council on Global Affairs, former U.S. ambassador to NATO. And to his left, we've got Frederick Kemp. Fred is the president and CEO of the Atlantic Council, author and former editor and reporter at the Wall Street Journal. And on this side, closest to me, we've got Bob Pape, who's a professor of political science at the University of Chicago and director of the Chicago Project on Security and Terrorism. And we also have as our moderator today, Carol Giacomo, who's on the far side there, who is a member of the editorial board of the New York Times and a former diplomatic correspondent from Reuters. Before the panel discussion, I want to introduce my colleague, Dina Smeltz, who is a senior fellow on public opinion and foreign policy and the leader of the team that produced today's report. And she will start off by setting up some of the key findings of the report. So thank you for being here. And Dina, please.
Thank you all for coming today. As Brian said, you can hear, right? Foreign policy has played kind of an outsized role in these elections compared to the past couple of years of elections. And one of these reasons is because Donald Trump has been arguing for a foreign policy that's different from the past 70 years of traditional U.S. foreign policy built on alliances and trade and openness to the world. So I'm going to quickly go through some of the highlights of the survey because I want to get to the discussion as much as possible. So we're just going to flip through a few slides that give you the overall feel of the survey. The survey was conducted between June 10th to 27th, 2016. It was conducted among over 2,000 people, and it was randomly represented sample conducted online. And if you all, I think, have the report on your chairs, page 37 has more about the methodology if you're interested in that. And the key takeaways from the survey report are that Donald Trump has been able to harness the energy of a certain segment of the population that is particularly discontent about immigration into the United States and about trade. And while these seem to have heightened during this election season, these attitudes are not new. These objections to trade and immigration have been going on for quite some time. And in the near term, these concerns are not likely to fade away. So we're going to start with what is a core supporter? We asked Americans whether which of these top primary candidates, and we listed all of them, were their top choice for president among the whole list. And they could answer Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump, Bernie Sanders, Ted Cruz, John Kasich, numerous others, and they could also write anybody in that they wanted to. And so you'll see that, and as you know, Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump both positioned themselves as outsiders, and they did quite well among the electorate. About a third of Republicans supported Donald Trump in the primaries and 15% of independents, and about a third of Democrats supported Bernie Sanders with a chunk, 27% of independents as well. So when we started digging into the data, we thought we would find some really interesting similarities between those people who wanted outsider candidates. But when we looked at the opinions of the Hillary Clinton supporters with the Bernie Sanders supporters, we were really surprised that we actually found very little differences, even on items like climate change and the Trans-Pacific Trade Partnership. But when we looked at the supporters of Donald Trump, there was quite a bit of difference between the views of other Americans and even among the Republican Party. So we've kind of zeroed in on those core supporters to try to understand this political moment. So every year we ask Americans, we show them a list of potential threats to the United States. And we ask them to rate whether they're critical, important, but not critical, or not important at all. And so hopefully it's clear from the columns, if you look at the blue donkeys, those are the Democrats, the yellow column is independents, the red columns are Republicans, and the orange column are the core Trump supporters. And the core Trump supporters, if you look at their top three threats, they're really in the same ballpark. 8 in 10 say that international terrorism is a critical threat. 8 in 10 say that large numbers of immigrants and refugees coming into the United States are a critical threat. And about 8 in 10 also say that Islamic fundamentalism is a critical threat. When you look at Republicans moving to the left, you see that those same three threats are rated critically, or as critical threats, but there is a distinct placement of immigration being third, not on top with international terrorism. And then for Democrats and independents, immigration doesn't even really rate in the top three or five in terms of critical threats. So then, as the previous graph showed, the core Trump supporters tend to blur the distinctions between Islamic fundamentalism, terrorism, and immigration. And so have some of the candidates that were in the primaries were blending these together to create fear that was connected. And I think this shows up in the core Trump supporters' views of specific immigrant groups, specifically the Middle Eastern immigrants. Only 15% of core Trump supporters say they have a favorable view of Middle Eastern immigrants compared to 4 in 10 Americans overall. And only 33% of core Trump supporters have a favorable view of Mexican immigrants in the United States compared to 60% overall. So this is the one immigration, not just on these questions, but on each and every question, the core Trump supporters clearly stood out in their unfavorable views. This is a little bit more complicated graph. Of course, one of the major issues and sticking points in comprehensive immigration reform has been what to do with the undocumented workers living in the country now. And this, the top two sets of bars represent support for a path to citizenship, either with conditions such as waiting a few years and paying a fine, or with no conditions at all. But the bottom set of the bottom row shows the percentage of Americans who support deporting undocumented workers living in the U.S. And you see that a majority of Trump supporters support deportation, and they stand out from the rest of Americans, only 28% overall versus 63% of the core Trump supporters. So now on globalization, I had said that globalization and trade were the two defining characteristics for the core Trump supporters. We asked a question about globalization. Do you think the increasing connections of our economy with others around the world is mostly good or mostly bad? And about half of Trump supporters say it is good compared to majorities of everybody else. Half is still pretty high, but it's lower than the 2 in 3 overall. And then we also asked about specific aspects of trade and whether trade is good or bad for consumers like you, your own standard of living, the US economy, and the core Trump supporters are the least likely to say that trade has been good on any of these elements. We did also ask about trade's impact on jobs and job security. And regardless of political affiliation, all Americans do see trade having a negative influence on jobs and job security. But at the same time, they're able to recognize that there have been advantages to trade, especially as consumers and their own standard of living and for US companies and economy. So as I said at the outset, these criticisms of immigration and trade are not new. In fact, we have asked Americans about immigration being a critical threat since 1998. And between 1998 and 2002, Republicans and Democrats all felt similarly. But since 2002, Democrats have become steadily less likely to view immigration as a threat, while Republicans have remained concerned about immigration and, in fact, are now at the highest level of concern since we've had in the surveys. And the 40 percentage point difference between Democrats and Republicans today is a historic high for this gap. So then on globalization, it's a similar story that since 1998, Republicans have become less supportive of globalization and Democrats have become more supportive. Though between 1998 and 2006, Democrats and Republicans were pretty much in the same range. So on the broader issues of international engagement, Americans are more like-minded, including the core supporters of Donald Trump. We really didn't see a connection between what Donald Trump is espousing in terms of allies being free riders and we need to revisit our relationships with our alliance partners. But instead, a majority still believe that NATO is essential. Trump supporters and everybody else believes that the United States should maintain and perhaps even increase our commitment to NATO. 2/3 of Americans say that we should take an active part in world affairs today, similar to what it's been going back to 74. And 85% think that maintaining military superiority is an effective method to achieve US foreign policy goals. So again, Donald Trump's hardline position on immigration and trade have resonated with his base supporters, who express more intense objections to these issues than Republicans and other Americans. But these concerns are not new. Democrats and Republicans have expressed diverging opinions about immigration since 2002 and diverging opinions about globalization to a lesser extent, but still since 2008. It's also important to keep in mind that the core Trump supporters' views are attractive to only a minority of Americans. Sometimes it's hard to remember that with all the noise of the campaign, but a majority of Americans say that a pathway to citizenship is the right way to deal with undocumented immigrants. Americans overall think globalization is mostly good, and they see many benefits to free trade. So while these objections to trade and immigration among these core Trump supporters are likely to stay with us and have to be addressed in the near term, in the longer term, the demographic trends that are happening in the United States today suggest that there will be more openness to immigration and trade and the world because those segments of the United States population that are growing most quickly, non-whites, the millennial generation becoming the biggest cohort after the baby boomers, and college educated are all more committed to openness toward the world. So with that, I'm going to stop and hand it over to Carol, and we'll start our discussion.
So this report is called America in the Age of Uncertainty. I mean, really, it seems to me that we've had a lot of uncertainty. Is there ever a time when we've had absolute certainty? So talk to me about what you think this title means, and is it any different from the past? Why don't we start with Bob?
I think that what I see in America in this age of uncertainty is that Americans have a consensus of how to think about it. We're going through a very divisive set of campaigns, but what this report shows more than anything else is an amazing degree of consensus. If you just put aside immigration, almost everything else in this report is a story of consensus. And that goes from how we identify the top security threat, which is terrorism. All the factions, including the Donald Trump factions, all agree, almost to the point. If you look at globalization, where you might expect the biggest divergence between the Trump supporters, half of the Trump supporters, the difference is between half and three quarters of the rest of the country, agree we should remain engaged. What you see here is the world, we are not moving to a public where half of us want to become isolationists, the other half don't. What you are seeing here is there's uncertainty in the world, and America wants to be engaged in the world, probably to help manage the uncertainty.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think that's right. I think there's, what's striking is the disconnect between the public discourse, particularly during the campaign, and the public itself. Now, the public hasn't voted yet, so maybe that's, you know, the noise level seems to indicate a degree of division that our opinion poll, when it comes to foreign policy, doesn't find. There is a faction that on issues of immigration and trade, in particular, takes a view that is different from the majority, but that is a small faction. It happens to be a very loud faction, and Donald Trump has mobilized that faction more effectively than anyone before him. It's existed for a long time. It will continue to exist after him, but it is a minority. And yet, it is a debate between that minority and the majority, and the tumult that has come with that in some way paints a picture of a deeply divided nation that is uncertain about the course that the nation needs to take in the world. And yet, when you really get to the bottom of it, this is not a divided nation. This is a quite united nation when it comes to the main ways of thinking about foreign policy, why the United States should engage, how it should engage, and that whatever differences are there have been there for a decade or two, and they're not surprising. It's why we have different political parties that represent different strands. So the uncertainty is the rhetoric surrounding this campaign that in fact isn't reflected in the opinion polling itself.
Yeah, I just wanted to add, I think also maybe there was more of a time of certainty during the Cold War when it was clear that we had one global adversary, where today our threats are transnational and also we're not really sure how best to address them. So I think that adds to the uncertainty.
I want to talk about that first, to the age of uncertainty question, and then what this poll says about what the next president could do about it. Mm-hmm. So my own view is that we're at a moment, a defining moment of history as important as the end of World War I, end of World War II, end of the Cold War. So that means we not only need a good president, we probably need a great president at this moment of history. What you said about the Cold War is absolutely right. We just did a report called Global Risk 2035, written by someone who'd done this kind of work in the intelligence world for many years, Matt Burroughs, I think you know his name. And he said the biggest changes over the last 4 years when he had written it for the National Intelligence Council were, number one, that we have the risk of major power conflict back. Not likely, but it was unthinkable a few years ago, and now it's back on the radar screen. Number two, you have the fraying of Western societies. And then finally, you have a breakdown of the global system, liberal international order that was established after World War II. He says the breakdown's irrevocable. I'm not sure. But essentially, we created the West,
yeah.
A world order after with our allies, U.S. and our allies after 1945, NATO, U.N., European Coal and Steel Community, which became the European Union, the Bretton Woods institutions. And the real question is, can this order survive in the time to come? And the fact of the matter is, it's less and less clear that it can and won't have to be adjusted wholesale with China starting parallel institutions, China and others, and Russia and Iran and others, feeling these institutions don't properly reflect them. So there's also a threat of the breakdown of the global system. This is uncertainty. When we created all this in 1945, we had 50% of global GDP. Now we have 18% of global GDP. We have less power to get things done unless we can do it in a consensual way with friends and allies. What I find encouraging about this report is you would think from watching the debates and from watching this whole election that America doesn't have the political will to lead any longer, and that's part of the reason why we don't. That Syria, Ukraine, et cetera, are manifestations of the US leaving vacuums that others are filling. What this report tells me is the American people are ready to be led by the right leader, giving the right reasons, not troops on the ground, not invading all over the place, but engagement in the world. The feelings on globalization are so contrary to both candidates being against TPP right now. It looks as though the American people could be led in a direction to support trade agreements. The military, the fact that people still want a strong defense, the fact that people are still supporting NATO. So the real question for me out of this report is why aren't these attitudes more reflected in the politics of the moment? Yes.
What's the answer to that question? Does anybody know?
Opinion polling is a snapshot. You're measuring views at a particular moment and you don't measure intensity. And it is always the case that minorities tend to believe what they believe more intensely than majorities. So yes, we find 62% of the American public is in favor of TPP. If you would ask what is in TPP, I doubt 60% of the American public would know. But those who are against it will know why they're against it more than those who are in favor of it. So intensity is a measure, and is part of the discussion. And intensity is mobilizable in a way that intense opinion is mobilizable in a way that non-intense opinion is more difficult to mobilize. It's enabling, and I think in some ways what the poll shows, it explains why Trump is doing as well as he is, because he mobilized a core constituency that feels very strongly that trade is bad and that immigration is bad. And he is able to do that. And we demonstrate that in the poll. Mm-hmm. On the opposite side, I think exactly as Fred puts it, this poll also shows that there is a way for leadership to make the contrary argument and get the rest of the American public to follow. And that the idea which has been around now in Washington for at least 8 years, and perhaps even longer, that the American public is basically isolationist, basically wants to retreat from the world, an idea, by the way, that other public opinion polls have fed, in part because they're asking questions that sort of lead you into that direction. But we've never found. We have found consistently 2/3 of the American public believe that the United States should have an active role in world affairs, and 1/3 saying, we want to stay out of world affairs. So you have an enabling majority that with good leadership, which is what politics is all about, you can mobilize a sensible international foreign policy based on the kind of consensus way we have been doing business for the last 70 years. And that is a very important finding.
Yeah, so just to amplify that a little bit, the report doesn't just show that Donald Trump's rhetoric is out of sync with the majority of Americans. The report shows that Donald Trump's rhetoric is largely out of sync with his own supporters. Now, except for the issue of immigration, all of the issues, Trump supporters are closer to the Clinton supporters than they are to Donald Trump. So let me just give you an example. This is just with Trump supporters. Commitment to US military allies. 84% of Trump supporters think maintaining the current US commitment is somewhat or very effective. 77% want to increase those military commitments. NATO, 51% of Trump supporters want to keep the current commitment. 9% more want to increase the commitment. 60%, think about that for a moment. So what's happening is on some of the very core issues, keeping bases in Asia, 66 to 72% of Trump supporters want to maintain bases in South Korea and Japan. Think of Trump is calling for eliminating those bases, letting them go nuclear. There's no indication in this report that Trump supporters support Trump on pretty much anything but immigration. And that's a very, that's an opportunity for well, depending on who the next president is, it's either an opportunity or a big problem, if you see what I mean.
So does this situation exist because he has been so effective at making immigration a driver that everybody who subscribes to that view are just willing to ignore everything else?
I think that what you're seeing in this poll, to be honest, is information I've not seen in any other poll. So this isn't just, we're so inundated with polls these days.
Right.
How do we know? Well, I'm telling you, I spend a lot of time studying these polls. That's part of what we got to do as a professor of info. And what is here is some striking new information that's not at 538, that's not at the Pew polls. And I think that what's happening here is that, they're being a little humble here, but there's really striking new information. And it's about Trump himself and his supporters himself. And this is something that I think is going to be a real problem. If Trump wins and he wants to go do all these policies, is he's going to have his own supporters supporting these policies?
I think there are two reasons why the politics of the moment doesn't really reflect the findings here and why mainstream ideas in general are not fully reflected, independent ideas are not fully reflected. One of them is the way the electoral map is set up. So you have Republicans on the right, you have far, you have moderate, and then imagine this graph going into independents. And then independent center going to Democrats, moderate center, and then left. The whole primary is taking place on the left and the right.
Mm-hmm.
And so the ideas that are getting pushed forward are these more extreme ideas,
mm-hmm.
anti-globalization, anti-immigrant, and so forth. Maybe Donald Trump is right in one thing, the fact the system is rigged, but it's rigged against independents. Mm-hmm. And so you have a duopoly where it's really hard for an independent party to break through the debate rules, the electoral rules, everything else. And so what happens is these views don't really come out until later in the electoral campaign when the debate is pretty much already established. So that's one reason I think comes up. The other is if you're against globalization, you've lost your job, you're worrying, you're worried about the future, you're not sure you can feed your family, all of that business, and you're pretty passionate about it. If you've actually profited from globalization, you don't carry placards out there saying, go globalization.
Right.
And I think it's also true, I think it's also true for immigration. You know, those who are pro-immigrant, my parents are immigrants. I don't hold up a placard, say, go immigration, though I should. And so if you're more passionate about these things, I think you're just louder. And the fans of globalization, the fans of immigration just don't trumpet their views.
Tina?
Yeah, and I just wanted to add on to that. Also, if you're a core supporter of Donald Trump and in the poll and support him for the primary, that's a different person than the activists that we see at the rallies and holding the signs.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it just shows that a vocal minority can paint a picture that's not true for everyone in the group. But you had mentioned, your other question was about what's driving the Trump movement or momentum. One is the immigration and trade, but also I heard yesterday somebody was explaining it that instead of the culture wars of the past, this is a nostalgia war, and that the Trump supporters are reacting to the changing world around them, the changing country, demographically, and one of the really strong variables in our data was that the Trump supporters were the least likely to say that the next generation of Americans will be better off than adults today. So they were the most economically pessimistic, even though they weren't of a lower income level than any other American.
What do you read out of this survey in terms of the support for military superiority, greater military budgets? I mean, do you see people, I think, Ivo, you may have mentioned, well, we don't, you know, Americans don't want troops on the ground, but what do they want America to do with that military clout?
It's pretty clear in the report. So there's a part of the report that she didn't present, and, you know, it has to do with those intervention questions. Mm-hmm. And what you see is virtually double the support for using air power as for ground power across all the different factions. Mm-hmm. It's not that there's they're not exactly the same to every nth degree, mm-hmm. but across every single layer, Trump, et cetera, mm-hmm. what you see is everybody wants air power. They're very focused on terrorism. And so what that means is you're likely going to see the continuation of essentially the Obama foreign policy in the Middle East. Mm-hmm. So he's being criticized right and left for using air power, not being more aggressive with troops or something mm-hmm. else on mm-hmm. the ground. What this is basically overwhelming support, three-quarters of all of those constituencies essentially supporting the over-the-horizon campaigns.
I go even further than you, Bob. So I you're absolutely right that there is a basic support for military intervention as long as the risk to Americans is low to non-existent, which is why air power is so much more important than ground forces. The interesting thing is that even the critics of the Obama administration, this is where I'll go further than you, those who say we need to do more in Syria and everything else, they're all talking about options that are minimal risk to American soldiers because exactly. they don't involve ground forces.
Exactly.
They talk about, let's take out the Syrian Air Force, let's do a no-fly zone, let's do a safe zone that Arab troops will have to patrol because, of course, Americans can't. So the there is a shift. There's and I think Obama reflected that shift when he was elected in 2008. I don't think it has changed fundamentally from a belief by Americans that war must involve the use of American ground forces, as it did, for example, in the Gulf War in 1990-91, and in large numbers, and that stretched through to the Iraq War of 2003, and the Afghan, and there is a complete consensus in the American public, and we've documented that in our reports in the past, that Afghanistan and Iraq were a failure, were bad things. The American public doesn't think these were good wars, and they don't want to repeat them. So there is now a new consensus about American, about the use of American force, which is, yes, we're in favor of force to deal with the critical threats we face, but please let's do it in a way that minimizes risks to American troops.
I'd like to add, but I also like to ask a question from the poll to see if something came up along these lines. It's related, the question of do you want military superiority and would you use force, but it's not the same.
Right.
And, you know, one could argue that we won the Cold War because of military superiority that we did not use, right. but deterred. And so you're seeing not only in your poll, but in other polls now, more support for increased defense spending for the first time in a long time. Mm-hmm. It's still not a majority that wants more defense spending, but it's a larger percentage in recent polls I've looked at elsewhere as well. So do they want that because they feel they're afraid they're going to lose the superiority and therefore the deterrence effect? Or is it because it's for use in military situations? And I'm not sure your poll, whether one can discern that from the poll or not.
Yeah, we haven't asked that this year, but I think it probably is related, if it's current polls that you're referring to, the increase in concern about terrorism. ISIS has really activated Americans in terms of their anxiety about safety. And it's also, we do show that there's majority support for bases overseas as well. So I think, and majority, really high majority support maintaining our military edge in terms of superiority. So I think that they're all related.
I think the numbers show that the traditional way in which we have thought about our military has strong support. So we need to maintain military superiority designed in a, you know, in which we've had for a very long time. We want to have overseas bases. We want to have strong alliances. We want to deal with critical threats
and are happy to do so militarily. Mm-hmm. And that's the way we have engaged. There's very strong support for NATO. I mean, a remarkable number, 75% overall want to either maintain or increase the commitment to NATO. That's a remarkable number.
Only half say that it's in the critical U.S. interest. So
that was 65% says it's essential to American security.
Just the Trump supporters.
Which is a remarkable, it's a half of Trump supporters.
Yeah.
It's a remarkably large
number. So even half of Trump supporters.
Even half of Trump supporters think that NATO is essential.
I'm going to ask one more question, then we're going to have to go to the audience. But so what do you read out of all of this about how the United States should approach Russia? And I was curious that North Korea showed up as a concern, as high a concern as it was, since it hasn't been discussed in the campaign. And what is it, you know, what does the survey tell you about people think we should do about North Korea?
One of the big things that's very striking, so Dina presented what are the top three threats across the factions. If you go to the top five, which gives you as far down as you would want to go, Russia's not showing up.
Yeah.
What's next underneath the waterline she showed is nuclear proliferation.
But I wonder whether Russia would show up if you did the poll today more than it did, because this was in June, July, right? A lot has happened since then, including the DNC hacks, including Syria,
I would just point out that Russia has been central in the news. Syria, you remember 2013, the whole issue with gas. Russia's been in the news with in Ukraine, taking Crimea. Russia's shot down the airliner. It's not just the cyber attacks that Russia's been doing, but there's been a whole lot about Russia in the last 3 years. And what's really striking is it's just not reflected in any parts of the report.
Americans don't really see what's going on with Russia overseas as affecting us directly. But nuclear proliferation is and has been for a long time one of their highest concerns. And I think they see North Korea as being a bit more unstable. Yeah. But again, if North Korea attacks South Korea, only a minority of Americans, it's almost half actually, do support coming. But there's a distinction. It's something that happens over there doesn't necessarily affect us over here.
Well,
so it's pretty
low.
Well,
it will affect us because we've got 37,000 troops there. So,
it is the highest percentage reported in the last 40 years of Americans wanting to support North Korea.
Yeah, yeah.
Same is true. So the numbers on the Baltic states are not as high as NATO in general, but they're significant. I mean, Russia, it has dropped. So we do a thermometer reading where, 100 is love you dearly like us, and the zero is don't want anything to do with you. Russia is now at, 32?
40.
One of the lowest.
40%.
Lowest.
40.
On the thermometer reading, 40% doesn't 40. Mean 40% likes
yeah,
them.
Yeah, 40
they're,
degrees.
They're at 40 degrees, which they obviously don't live in Chicago. They're Florida voters in that kind of view. North Korea is interesting. It is very high. It's higher among Democrats than among Republicans. My view is that the biggest crisis confronting the United States in the next 4 years is going to be North Korea. Mm-hmm. It's the first time since 1964 that another country will have the capacity to deliver nuclear weapons against the United States. It's a big deal. It's a big deal in reality. It'll be a big deal. And I think the public is ready to see the threat. I don't think they're necessarily ready to do anything about it yet.
No, 2 in 3 Americans support continued cooperation and engagement with Russia rather than limiting or containing Russia. We're coming out in the next couple of days with this report. And the same with China. And I think also because Americans don't want to mess with an adversary that has a strong military like China and Russia, and we've seen that in the different scenarios, that they're less likely to support using U.S. troops in cases where it would involve us in a conflict with those two powers.
All right, I'm told that we're going to show a short clip. There were interviews done of people on the street asking questions about foreign policy issues.
Great.
We're going to show one, take that question, and then you all get a chance. So, I'm not quite sure how this happens.
The largest issue that is, I think, facing us, and certainly front and foremost in my mind, is the large global military footprint that we have today, which is expressing itself not just in Iraq and Afghanistan, but also now in a growing way in Syria and the wider land spreading west of Iraq. And the question to my mind, and the candidate which has the best and the most favorable position on actually contracting, shrinking that footprint as opposed to growing it, will probably be the one earning my vote. And that is the predominant issue that weighs upon me these days.
Okay, one word answer. The voter wants to know, who will shrink the military footprint? Fred?
Unfortunately, I think the answer to the voter is that the global situation won't allow it to be shrunk. Yeah. And, you know, again, just quoting from...
Candidate, though. Which candidate?
Neither. It won't be possible. And I don't think in their heart of hearts either candidate would think that they could.
I cannot speak for Donald Trump because I don't know. One day it's one way, one day it's the other way. But he has indicated that at times that he would shrink the footprint, and Clinton has indicated that she won't enlarge it. She's ruled out, for example, troops in Iraq and Syria. But I think it's probably a right conclusion to think that the footprint is going to stay what it is if it's not going to get larger.
You agree?
Yeah, I agree.
All right, who out there has a burning question? Oh, come on.
Andy,
Alyssa.
Wait for the mic.
Thank you. I'm looking at this this chart that shows the where there is the divergence on immigration between the Democrats, the Republicans, and the Independents. There's a high degree of consensus up till 2002, and then the divergence starts to show on the graph. And I'm wondering whether you have any thoughts, any of the speakers have any thoughts on why we began to see the parties grow apart on immigration starting 14 years ago or so.
I have some factual reasoning for you and some just speculative. So factually, the composition of the Democratic Party supporters has shifted over time. So now a lot of blue collar, not in terms of income, but non-college educated whites have moved from the Democratic Party to the Republican Party. And so that has attributed some, you can attribute some of that demographic shift to that declining fear of immigration among Democrats. I don't have a great answer yet, and I've asked a lot of people, but I think perhaps after 2001, when Homeland Security tightened up all those restrictions against people coming to visit the United States, and visas became very difficult, and some people were making criticisms of racial profiling, perhaps that was something that Democrats had affixed to, so because it's sort of like a human, I don't know, some kind of rights violation. Another thing is, I thought it was interesting too that George W. Bush in 2007, 2008 was trying to push comprehensive immigration reform, and perhaps that when that failed, that created even more of a gulf. But those are all just speculation.
I think they're great.
And also the changing demographics.
You need to have a microphone, otherwise you can't. Nobody can hear.
No, but, you're right.
So it is
the growing Hispanic population nationally.
Yes.
So there's the changing demographic. So the important about this immigration gap is it's the Democrats who are going down. That's the fundamental shift from worry about immigration to less worry about immigration. It goes from 55-60% to 27% in our most recent poll. And I think if you look at the Democratic electorate, it's a very different electorate today than it was then. It's much more diverse, much more, it's younger, it's more college educated. So it's all the reasons why you would think that those who are less worried about immigrants tend to be more Democratic in any case.
Yeah.
I think that's probably what's happening. And the Republican one is the immigration terrorism linkage.
Yeah, especially if...
Particularly in recent years where it goes up quite significant.
Exactly. I was just looking on page 15. You can see in 2014, Republicans were much lower on immigration being a critical threat, and then with ISIS and the Syrian refugee crisis, and then people conflating all of those issues together, there's been a steep rise. Thanks.
Sir.
While it's been encouraging that people are paying more attention to foreign affairs, even though they still can't tell me what country Benghazi is in, it seems, and even some of the stuff that your report is showing, is they're paying attention to things that our national security strategy and establishment is shifting away from. So, like, pivot or rebalance to Asia, a lot of, you know, the anti-TPP or anti-trade would work against that strategy, and it seems that the pivot to Asia means pivot away from the Middle East, and it seems policy wants to, you know, fight, get more involved in the Middle East, maybe not with ground troops, but in some other way. How is the next president going to deal with this? Is there going to be a continuing of the rebalance to Asia? What themes should we be looking for in the inaugural address in the next national security strategy?
So my take on this, I just had a delegation from China in my office a couple days ago, is that I told them that, in part based on your report, Ivo, that what this shows is that the next president is going to be very focused on the Middle East. I think that to the extent the next president is concerned about Asia, they are going to be concerned about North Korea. You've heard that discussion. And what I think that does is it creates enormous opportunity for cooperation. I think that it also means the next president is going to be so focused, some of those opportunities from cooperation would be helpful if they came from China. Because I think that they might be very receptive given what you see in this report. But I think that what you see in this report is that there's an awful lot on the next president's plate. There's many, many things. And the Middle East, terrorism is definitely front and center. And to the extent there's something second, it's proliferation, which, by the way, doesn't just mean North Korea, could mean issues with Iran. So again, back to the Middle East. And I think what that means for Asia, of all the different areas in the world, that's probably the area of most possible cooperation.
My impression, talking to people who are likely to be in this administration, is that there will be a coherent first 100 days where one sets a certain tone in foreign policy. And it will be quite intentional, and it's already been thought out. What's troubling is we don't know what that's going to be, because even though foreign policy was more of a theme, there's no mandate really for anything except for anti-trade in this campaign. The arguments have shed more heat than light on most foreign policy issues, and so I had hoped that this campaign would be a chance for a real good debate through the primary process and this about America's role in the world and what it should be, sort of teasing out more of the ideas that you see in this really excellent poll. The only thing that I'll say, from what I can gather in talking to people, I think that the Middle East will be important, but, you know, finding a solution is really hard, but you can't just let, you know, more tens of thousands of people die in Syria, and I think that is the attitude I hear from inside the campaign. Russia will play a bigger role than your poll cites. I mean, let's not forget whose emails were hacked, and who, what candidate the Russians are trying to ensure doesn't get elected. And Secretary Clinton invested a lot on the reset, as you know from your time in the administration, Ivo. And I think she's disappointed, and I think that there are things moving from the Russian side on so many different fronts, and I think there is a view within the administration that one is going to have to deal with that in some way, and probably counter it a little bit more than the Obama administration's had. And then finally, China as the strategic issue. And I think everybody has to face China as the strategic issue. This is the rising power. This is the most important other power in the world. And everywhere the U.S. goes, China is there, whether it's Latin America, whether it's Africa, whether it's Asia, whether it's the South China Sea. And so in a strategic sense, I think my feeling is that the administration will make that a highest priority.
Maybe so, just to say it in a slightly different way, agreeing with Fred, is I think the number one issue facing the United States is the credibility of the country with regard to global engagement.
Mm-hmm.
This election campaign, contrary to our opinion poll, has put that into question with regard to Europe, the Middle East, and Asia. TPP,
and what it stands for in both party or with both candidates is indicative of the need for reassurance. So I think job one for the next president, whoever she or she is, is to reassure our traditional partners, first and foremost in Europe and Asia, actually in Asia and Europe in that order.
And the Middle East.
I said first and foremost in Asia and Europe, maybe also in the Middle East, but I think it's more important to do it in Asia and Europe because of that liberal international order that is supported by U.S. power multiplied by strong partnerships in Europe and Asia, is to reassure that the United States is an Asia-Pacific power, a European power, and a global power. And that is, and if anything the first 100 days must do, it is to, not just through speeches, but through action, demonstrate that that is, that is what the United States is about in the next 4 years.
Mm-hmm. Other questions? Sir.
Eva, just picking up on that, specific actions, could you maybe, would you be able to expand on that a little bit?
So
to assure credibility.
So just one specific action that I think is critical. Assuming that TPP does not get passed by Congress, and I think it's a reasonable assumption, I very much hope that it gets through in the lame duck session, but if it doesn't, I think one of the first things that the president needs to do is to have a summit level meeting with the 12 TPP countries, whether in Washington or anywhere else, to say, we're going to fix this. We're going to figure out a way to do TPP plus in order for me to be able to support it and get it through Congress. Because if we lose TPP and we lose what's happening in Asia, I just came back from Singapore and Hong Kong last week, the worry in the region about our commitment is very real, and TPP is the linchpin for its, and as Secretary Kerry, who spoke at the council here last night, said so strongly, this is it. And I think that's number one to be done. I think Europe is a tougher nut to crack, but this one is, as we see with the Philippines and other places, this is something you can truly lose, and finding a way to make sure that doesn't happen, I think, would be top of mind.
A woman right there.
Just a small point. You know, we are always hearing that ISIL is behind all the global terrorist acts. But if you look at the list of the top five critical threats, I noticed that Islamic fundamentalism isn't something that Democrats picked up. And it's there for all the other groups. And I'm wondering what you think about that. Is that just they're being politically correct and they don't want to point to a particular group, or they truly don't believe that that's the cause behind global terrorism? What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, so my thoughts on this is the Obama administration has tried for 8 years to separate Islam from terrorism. They've done that because they're very concerned that if we join them together, it plays into the terrorist hands. And as somebody who studies their propaganda, there is a strong case to be made that joining does help the terrorist recruit. So I think what you're seeing is the divide on the rhetoric of the top leaders. So you, not just with Hillary Clinton, but Bernie Sanders, there's a whole variety of top leaders on the Democratic side that have essentially accepted that it's in our security interest to divorce Islam from the word terrorism. And on the other side, there's just been very strong criticism from the Republicans pretty much across the board on this. And I think that that's what's reflected in that difference.
Yeah. Sir.
Do you think we're losing respect around the world, given when we tip our card and say, no troops on the ground, and we know that air power is very limited, given the bogus wars we've been in, the public doesn't want to stomach having troops and so forth. And given the provocations by the Iranians in the Persian Gulf, and given what the president of the Philippines insulted our president, I'd like you to comment on that a little bit.
Fred, you want to? I'm happy to.
You go first, I'll go first.
I think there is a I think there is a concern about the degree of which, by which the United States wants to continue to be engaged in the world. I think there is. I think there is in Asia. I think there is in Europe. I think there is in the Middle East. Now, you know, by the way, this is nothing new. This concern existed in the 1960s in Europe when we were fighting a war that that most people in the world, certainly everybody in Europe, thought was a stupid war to be fighting. There was a great deal of concern about American staying power, and there's been this is nothing new. When you're in a big power, people worry about two things: either that you use power too much, or you don't use it enough. And right now, we may be in a period where they're a little bit more worried about us not using power enough. After, by the way, a period when most people were worried about we're using a little bit too much. And there's this natural cyclical tendency in American foreign policy, and in how it is perceived. From what Stephen Sestanovich, in a very nice book he published a couple of years ago, called From a Maximalist to a Minimalist Foreign Policy. And we clearly had a maximalist wave in the first part of this century. We then had, we're now in a minimalist wave, and we'll probably come up again in a more maximalist tendency. And so people are reacting to that. And I think that's, you can always take a vignette here and a vignette there, but the reality is once you retrench a little bit, people are going to be worried that you're moving too far away, and pretty soon they'll be worried that we're too dominant again.
So just to answer your question more from the side of the enemy, so are we tipping our hand to the enemy? So that is a lot of what I study. And the table right next to you are 10 of my CPOST researchers. So this is a fairly large organization that it's not just me who does the study of terrorist propaganda and so forth. And it may come as a surprise because you don't see much of the propaganda really on TV, that ISIS is baiting us, practically begging us to deploy a ground army. Why would they do that? Because the presence of our military forces is their best recruiting appeal. That's what gets them more people than anything else. Now, we may not like to believe that, but it is what they're counting on. And what they're doing right now is losing. They're losing badly. And so, believe it or not, they have videos that are actually taunting us, daring us, calling for us to come and fight like men. Because otherwise, they're just going to go down the tubes.
This reaches back to your question as well. I think one of the first things that a Clinton administration, I do think a Trump administration is more unpredictable. But in a Clinton administration, I think that you will have, in the first 100 days, some action that shows deeper engagement on issues of a sort that might reassure allies. And also some action, I think, again, I'm focusing on the Russians here a little bit, but the Obama administration has promised a proportional response to the cyber attacks. I'm not sure if you'll get that within the Obama administration. I think the clock is being played out, and that will get me to this question. But I think within the early days of the Clinton administration, whether you see it or not, there will be a response. Now, in terms of, I wrote a book called Berlin 1961. And one of the major points
great
of the
book,
thank you. The discount for every no. Yeah, one of the chief points of the book was that the acquiescence to the building of the Berlin Wall in August of '61 didn't actually make the world a better or safer place. Over a short term, it made it a more dangerous place because President Khrushchev. The party leader Khrushchev assumed that Kennedy could be had, that Kennedy had showed weakness to him through the Bay of Pigs, through the Berlin Wall, et cetera, in his first year in office. Then came 1962 and the Cuban Missile Crisis, prompted not in small part by what had come before then, and at that point Kennedy drew the line, and from that point on, we were actually in a safer place in the Cold War. It was pretty dangerous from 45 to 61, 62. My point in that is there was a miscalculation on Khrushchev's part of Kennedy's willingness to stand up. I think that might happen among adversaries at the moment. that the Russians might just go a little bit too far, and that would be a dangerous place to be. And so I really worry about the final months, final weeks of the Obama administration and the early weeks of a new administration, which might be a tempting moment for people to do a number of different things. And I think we're seeing some of that already happening. And you know, I won't go into a lot of details, but there are a few examples of that sort of thing happening. And the real question might one misread our intent to the point where we have to respond at some point, and then that would be really dangerous. But I do think, the reason I talked about the Middle East before is I've been traveling a lot around the world, but particularly in the Middle East in the last 2 years. And our allies in the Middle East are concerned. Yeah. They feel there's been too big of a tilt to Iran, that their interests are being taken care of. Whether you agree with that or not, it underscores what you were saying, is they feel that we're, they're not sure they can count on us.
But let's be clear that those same allies were deeply concerned about us in 2003, 4, 5, yeah. That we were too much engaged. That is, the natural inclination of allies is never to be satisfied, and the natural inclination of hegemons is never to be satisfied with their allies, which is why we're having these debates. So it is in that sense quite...
Though you might have had a pendulum swing a little bit too far.
Well, maybe and that's why, right that's why pendulums yeah. swing, right? If they don't swing far enough, they don't come back. So
there you go.
All right, we'll take one more question.
That's great.
Anybody got a burning thought? Sir?
Just on the trade question, and generally in TPP specifically, one of the striking things about the poll is it's suggesting that Democrats are more pro-free trade than Republicans. Historically, the Republican yeah. elite has been default free trade enthusiastic in thought and action and rhetoric, but it appears their base, their core voters, aren't following. How is that going to play out, one, for the Republican Party, and two, putting together coalitions in Congress where we could do TPP plus or TPP in the lame duck? How's it going to play out? Because historically, the solid component of free trade was Republican leadership support. Will it be there, and will they stand up?
So can I just say a word? So the report actually has several sections in it that deal with why different groups are upset about trade. And what you see underneath the water is that what they're upset about when they're upset is the loss of their own personal jobs. And what you see across the factions is the Republicans and then the Trump supporters are the most upset about the risk of losing their jobs. And that dovetails with the demographics that Evo's got, or that Dina and Evo have in their report about who the Trump core supporters are, sir. So what I'm saying is that the report actually it has the information to suggest that what's likely going to happen is the next president, whoever it is going to have to not curtail trade, but make sure trade does more to produce jobs in the United States.
Yeah, I think that's one part. The other part is I do think you're looking at the beginnings of, or the middle of, a realignment where on trade, and so it's happened on immigration, where the Democratic Party has become pro-immigration in a way that it didn't used to be, because immigrants were a problem in the 1950s and 60s for working class jobs. Now it's shifted. I think you're seeing a similar realignment that's at least happening in the Republican Party. Its base is no longer in the same place where the leadership is. So what the question there, and this is the Trump phenomenon writ large, so the question is, what is that going to do to the Republican Party? And this is going to be the big issue, seems to me, for the next 4 years, is for the Republican Party to figure out what is its base, how does it maximize that base, and where is trade going to play in a role? I mean, it was striking that of the 16 candidates that were running for president on the Republican side, only one was pro-immigration, who happened to be married to a Mexican. That was Jeb Bush. Everyone else had a very strong anti-immigration net. Immigration was not an issue in the Democratic Party. It was very pro-immigration reform. Mm-hmm. And so I think the next issue where this is going to shift is likely to be on trade.
If you do a vote count now, on TPP or coming up TTIP. It's the Republicans that will get it done. And President Obama knows that, his people know that. It's the reason why his trade representative, Mike Froman's been up there making sure he keeps those Republican votes. If you get all the Democrats who voted for Colombia and South Korea, you then have enough to do the deal. I fear that because of the way Secretary Clinton has campaigned, that she won't be able to revisit trade very soon.
Right.
And if she doesn't revisit trade very soon, we may lose the historic opportunity. Yep. And it really is going to hurt us. And it's really going to hurt us geopolitically. Therefore, I think it's in her interest, and I think she'll make it known in the way that people do quietly, that in the lame duck you get something done. Because the last thing you want is this slopping over into your administration when you've campaigned the way that you have. And so I think the votes are there. If the Republicans are willing to give Obama a victory in his final month, and they may be willing to, seeing what's coming forward on trade. But where you're right is the Republican, I'm not sure where the Democratic coalition's going to go. I have more doubts about that. But you're getting more Republicans elected who aren't free trade.
Right.
And so what you're getting is a Congress that doesn't reflect this at all, this poll at all, in terms of globalization and trade,
yeah,
which is really interesting. Yeah. And I don't know how quickly that shifts, because the people who are lobbying for these trade deals on the Hill bemoan the fact that it's really hard to find, it's hard to find anyone on the Hill who really gets any boost out of
right.
being for trade.
Dina gets the last word.
Okay, yeah, so I think Hillary Clinton's been fairly smart in the way she positions her criticisms of the TPP and trade. Is she focuses on trade's bad effect on jobs and also on depressing wages here in the U.S. And polls have, I mean, she's reading polls. Clearly, the polls have shown that those are two issues where people see disadvantages. Of course, the data show that there people do recognize advantages too, but those don't get touted that much. So,
thanks very much for coming.
Thank you. Thank you.